City Church. We have been in this community for a little over 10 years, moved into this building a couple of years ago. But Michael and I have served together on the board of Christianity Today for the last couple of years, and when I learned that he was going to be in town, I just said, why don't we try to pull together a couple of opportunities for him to meet people here in the Twin Cities. And so we have this event, we have another tomorrow, so you're welcome to come back here tomorrow from 9 to noon. This is focused on those who have connections and work with students. Michael is college president, Gordon College, and previous to that was a sociology professor at Rice University. And then there are other pieces to his biography, including working with the Gallup organization. Has done a lot of research in the area of leadership, and now works with students, and so thinking about issues like vocation and faith and work from a more a little bit younger angle is something that he's been immersed in for the last couple of years. So without any further ado, Michael, why don't you take this away?
Okay. Thank you. So it's really good to be here. Thank you, John, for the invitation. And I'm excited to share with you some of the things that I've been learning. So for 5 years, I was a faculty member at Rice in Houston. And prior to that, I did my doctoral work at Princeton. I started out because I was very interested in how leadership works in American culture. And in sociology, I set a goal to try and do 40 face-to-face interviews with people of faith who were in leadership positions in government, business, and nonprofit life. And I really wanted to reach sort of very high level of folks. And so I had an ambitious start, and the goal was to do 40 interviews. After doing about 40 of those interviews, and I had gotten a chance to meet some amazing people, I interviewed former presidents Carter and Bush, James Baker, who had been Secretary of State and Secretary of the Treasury, Mike Duke, who was the CEO of Walmart. I went to my dissertation committee and said, I've done these interviews and I'm ready to start writing. And they said, well, are there other people who have agreed to give interviews? And I gave them a list of names, and they were a number of different CEOs and other leaders. And they said, oh, this is great. Go back out into the field and do more interviews. So I did another 60 interviews, completed 100 interviews, went to my dissertation committee, and was telling them the plan of what I was going to write about. And they said, are there other people that have agreed to be in the study? And I said, yes. And they gave me some names. And they said, you need to go back into the field. So I went back and I did another 100 interviews. And then I came back to them. And this time, at the start of the meeting, I said, yes, there are more people. Here are the other people that have agreed. And they said, go back into the field. As it turned out, interviewing leaders in different sectors just became a part of my life. And actually, I spent 10 years of my life interviewing folks in many different sectors. As it turned out, the largest study ever conducted of senior leaders based on face-to-face interviews was conducted in the early 1970s by a team of researchers at Columbia University. They interviewed 545 people. So my goal was 546. In the end, I did 550 interviews. I burned 400,000 miles in the process of doing it. It was all based in the United States, but included people from many different races and ethnicities, because leaders in the U.S. come from many different walks of life. I interviewed people all the way from Bar Harbor, Maine, which is the very, very tip top of Maine, to Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, and every place in between. I interviewed U.S. cabinet secretaries like Condoleezza Rice and Colin Powell, Donna Shalala, Wesley Clark. I interviewed 250 CEOs of large companies, including 20 of the Fortune 100 CEOs, including interviews here in the Twin Cities area, Greg Page from Cargill. I interviewed Ken Melrose from Toro. I interviewed just a wonderful array of people, as well as 250 CEOs of large nonprofits, everything from the head of the Salvation Army and the American Cancer Society to the presidents of Harvard, Princeton, and Stanford. So I'm living proof that you can write a dissertation that your wife will describe as actually interesting. And this morning, what I want to share with you is some of the things that I learned about helping to develop the next generation of leaders. And so thinking about, if you're working with students, what are ways in which we can sort of speak into their lives in a way that's built upon some empirical research? One of the key things that I've found that really matters is to embrace what I call a liberal arts approach to leadership. Today, we reward people in businesses or industries or vocations because they master a particular domain. They're very good. But actually what we find is that the higher up you move within an organization or a ministry, the more you need to have a broad-based perspective. You need to be able to be not a specialist, but a generalist. The problem is that once you enter into the workforce, there are very few opportunities to develop that generalist mindset. The research shows that it's typically cultivated in your teenage years and your 20s, this generalist mindset. So one of the things that I want to try and do when I'm working with students is help these young people to think broadly, like the liberal arts. So you're thinking in many different subjects. It's interesting because we found in our research that if you're trying to build connections with different people and you're wanting to see who's going to be a great leader, there's actually a very simple test. So if you've got, let's say, 20 high school seniors and you're trying to figure out who's going to be a great leader out of this 20, you take those students to a dinner party where they don't know anybody, and you test and see who's the best conversationalist. Because the student who's able to make conversation with many different people is likely to be the person who leads an enterprise when they're in their 30s, 40s, or 50s. Why? Because being able to build connections is the key variable when you're out there trying to connect with people. It's interesting. Leadership, people ask me, are leaders made or are they born? It's actually both. There are certain things that we expect of our leaders, and it changes over time and in different cultures. 500 years ago, if you wanted to be a leader in the world, there was one thing you had to be able to do better than other people. What was that 500 years ago in 1515?
Fight.
You actually had to be a warrior. And so if you were not physically strong, you actually could not be seen as a leader in that culture. 300 years ago, let's say it's 1715, and we're in Massachusetts. What are people looking for when they're thinking for a leader? It's actually education. Usually the person who was the most educated person in those New England colonies had the most cultural influence. Today, what is it? What's the most important thing that you have to have if you're going to be a leader? What's the most important skill?
An iPhone.
An iPhone. Well, there's something to that.
Charisma.
There's a skill you have to have. What did you say? Communication, and in particular, persuasion. Persuasion is the coin of the realm. So if you use your iPhone to persuade people, either on social media or by face-to-face conversation, that actually is the most important thing. So it does not matter if you're a pastor, if you're a business leader, if you're a politician, you actually have to be able to persuade. In fact, it's very interesting. There's some very interesting studies that have come out of the U.S. military over the last 15 years. Most senior leaders in the U.S. military, they get to those promotion positions because of their ability to persuade, which means you have to be able to build connections with people. If there's one conversation topic that's more important than any other at building connections with many different kinds of people, so if you want to be able to connect with people from lots of different stations, what's that subject? What's the topic you're going to try and use if you're just trying to build a connection with the widest group of people? What would you guess? What's the conversation topic?
Faith?
Possibly.
Politics.
What'd you say?
Politics.
Politics. You all are choosing all the divisive things, but no, it's not that. It's sports. That's right. John Somerville. Sports is the great bridge builder. If you're running for president of the United States and you're going to figure out a way to make a connection with dock workers at 10 o'clock in the morning over coffee and with nuclear physicists at 12 noon, the topic you will turn to first and foremost is sports. And it's interesting because you don't actually have to be an athlete yourself or really understand anything about sports to be able to open the conversation. So you just, you know, I live in Boston, so I just say, what do you think about the Red Sox this year? I don't know what I think about the Red Sox, but I don't have to. It just gets the conversation going. And that's why I say it's a liberal arts approach to leadership. Actually, what our young people need to develop is an ability to talk about many different things. It's not about depth as much as it is breadth. So very practically, I encourage young people to get a subscription to The Economist. Why? It's a magazine that's published in the UK. It covers world affairs from a different perspective. So it's different than what they're going to hear on CNN or on Fox News. It's a different perspective. And it also allows them to engage on everything from world sport to science and technology to politics. a liberal arts approach to leadership. It's very important. One of the key things that we want to try and instill in the next generation is what we would call a moral imagination. Now, by this, I'm not really talking about an understanding about ethics and rules and ways in which we follow, but instead, it's actually to allow young people the ability to conceive of what would be a right decision in an unrecognizable future. You see, the great ethical challenges that 20-year-olds are going to face over their life have actually not yet been invented. Anyone have an idea of what created the greatest ethical conundrum of our generation?
Abortion.
Abortion's a good guess. It's not abortion.
Drugs.
Contraception's a good guess. That's not it.
Drugs?
No.
Cloning.
Sorry?
The cloning.
You're very close. You're very close. It's the mapping of the human genome. The most significant scientific discovery of our lifetime was led by a team of different researchers, five different researchers, led by actually an evangelical Christian. Anyone know his name?
Francis Collins.
He's now the director of the National Institutes of Health. Francis made a point of ensuring that the Human Genome Project included 5% of research on ethical considerations for the issues involved with mapping the human genome. In fact, because of that financial investment and strategic work that was occurring, we've actually avoided some of the big ethical problems that relate around cloning that could have come up in the earliest days of mapping the human genome. We couldn't even conceive mapping the human genome 30 years ago. And so it is for the young people that we work with today. We actually have to help instill within them a sense of right and wrong around rules that have not yet even come into play. So that's what a moral imagination seeks to do. This is Gerard Arpey. Gerard served as the CEO of American Airlines. He's a very interesting man because he was the number two guy at American Airlines on 9/11. As it turned out, the CEO was unavailable that day, so he was the person who had to make the decision to ground American Airlines when they knew that one of their planes had been hijacked and they had lost contact with a second plane. That one decision cost American Airlines $5 million. And he said, I didn't know if it was the right thing or not, but he said, I knew that if I was a pilot that morning, knowing what I know, I would want to be on the ground. Gerard's a committed Christian, has grown up Lutheran almost all of his life. And when I interviewed Gerard in 2010, he had a very interesting sort of take on what was happening in his own industry. As you may be aware, the airline industry has been a tough industry to make money off of in the last 15 years. American at that time had done had made a decision that they would not declare bankruptcy, even though every other competitor that they had declared bankruptcy. Now, it's interesting because all these airlines declared bankruptcy when, in fact, they actually had a lot of money in the bank. So considering them bankrupt was sort of a hard way of conceiving it because they had not run out of cash. But it was, in essence, a financial strategy to restructure their long-term financial obligations, particularly around labor contracts with unions. And so Delta, United, Continental, you name the firm, they had decided they would declare bankruptcy, but not American. And the reason, Gerard said, is because as long as I am CEO, I actually don't think I can in good conscience do that. You know, we've got this money in the bank, and while I would love for us to be able to renegotiate our labor contracts, I'm not going to just pull that trigger because I think it's the right, you know, it's the right financial decision. For me, this is fundamentally about a moral commitment. I had that interview with Gerard in April of 2010. One morning, I was watching the Today Show, turned it on, and they announced that American Airlines was declaring bankruptcy. I immediately thought of this interview with Gerard because I knew that he had said that would be, I would consider that a moral failure of my leadership. In the next paragraph, the news announcer said, and Gerard Arpey, the CEO, has stepped down from that job. It's interesting because in so doing, Gerard lost the golden parachute that he had. Making that decision, it actually cost him millions of dollars. I had a chance to follow up with Gerard because we had him to Gordon to talk about that particular decision. He said, you know, basically, Michael, what I concluded was that it was going to be a moral failure of our leadership, and I really disagree. The board, in the end, decided that that was the right thing that they wanted to do, and they asked me to stay on. And I said, you know what, actually, I just don't think I am the person to lead you through that process. I love that story because there are far too few examples in our world today of leaders who are willing to basically give up lots of perks and privileges, give up the title, give up the prestige, because of a moral conviction they have. Now, you and I could debate about whether it was a moral decision or the right decision for America to declare bankruptcy. But what I try to communicate to my students is that in the mind of this particular believer, he was convinced that that was going to be a moral failure of his leadership. And he'd rather give up the perks and privileges of a job than he would to break his own moral code. We need a lot more young people who have that kind of steeliness in their moral fiber. And sadly, there are not a lot of good examples. So I'd like to hold up the example of Gerard Arpey. I also interviewed a number of people who would talk about ethics. Now, one of the problems is that oftentimes when we think about ethics and morality, we think about sort of making a right or wrong decision. The higher up you move in an organization, and frankly, the older we get in life, the more you realize very rarely are the issues about black and white. They're always a deep shade of gray. So part of our job is to help young people to conceive of these situations, even though it may not turn into a yes or no decision. That's what the moral imagination is really trying to help develop. Now, so there's individual level ethics that occur, and we certainly know that we need to develop that. Probably the most important ethical conundrum that I think Christian young people need to look at today is actually how they steward privilege, power, and responsibility. We've written thousands of books about stewarding money, but very few books about stewarding power. And that's actually an indictment on our culture, because if there's ever been a generation who is endowed with more cultural influence, power, education, health, and wealth, it is the current generation of Christians in the United States of America. So we really need to think about how do we steward that appropriately and help to approach that. But this is actually just the first step in the process of developing a moral imagination. What we really want to do is to go to the next step, which is to help our young people to conceive of their ethical guidelines and responsibility to actually entail being a member of the common good, or working toward the common good, that there being an element of responsible citizenship. I think one of the real challenges that we face is helping our current students to actually aspire to and to pursue in a godly way responsible citizenship in our society. We're in a very interesting time where many Christian young people and Christian communities are feeling a bit under threat. All kinds of issues. I mean, just turn on the news and you can hear various examples of that. And anytime the Christian community has experienced that, there is a tendency to try and sort of isolate ourselves and to wall off the outside world and to become a bit of an enclave. I don't think that's the right way to go at all. I think actually one of the most important things that we can do in this current moment is to actually demonstrate responsible citizenship. This is Barry Rowan. Barry has been a very senior executive in the telecommunications industry. When he was in high school, he thought he wanted to be a medical doctor. But he said, as I got older, I began to realize, you know, as a doctor, I will be able to have an influence in the life of my patients and perhaps my particular sort of practice. But if I went into business and had a position in leadership in business, I could actually have an effect that would reach not just 8, 10, or 12 people, but actually would reach 8,000, 10,000, 12,000 people. So you just have a much bigger scale of opportunity. And I love the fact that Barry actually felt called to trying to use his influence in that kind of a way. So one of the things that we try to do is to give examples of young people who have gone on to make a positive difference for the common good in lots of different shapes and sizes. This is an interesting guy named Kevin Plank. Kevin was an average student, made mostly C's all through high school and college. He was a football player, ended up playing for the University of Maryland, but by his own admission, he was not bound for the NFL. He said, I had lots of friends who were actually getting drafted, but that was not going to be my future. But Kevin knew that he had a certain set of skills and abilities. He was very good at that persuasion that we talked about. He was a great salesman. In fact, he ran a Rose delivery service out of his dorm room, and he said, the business we had over Valentine's Day could actually pay for my spring semester. So he said, I really got into doing that. One day, he came in from football practice, took off his shoulder pads, and he said, I realized I was wearing this white t-shirt underneath, and it was just drenched in sweat. He said, I took off the t-shirt, and I put it on the scale. It weighed 6 pounds. And he said, I realized that actually that's like having a weight on my shoulders, and that if I could somehow come up with something where I didn't have to wear that t-shirt on, or it didn't get soaked with sweat, it would actually allow me to run faster, that it wouldn't feel so weighted down. And if there could be something that was like sort of breathable fabric, actually that could have a cooling effect because the sweat, as it evaporated, would actually lower my body temperature, so it would actually improve my performance. Kevin, at the end of his college career, had about $600. He said, I decided to take those $600 and to invest them in 6 different fibers to see if we could create basically a t-shirt that was breathable. As it turns out, one of those fabrics actually worked, and that became the beginning of what we now know as Under Armour. Kevin Plank is the founder of Under Armour, and he literally invented an industry called performance apparel. It occurred because Kevin was not the best student, was not the best athlete, but he was actually able to sort of live into his particular gifts and abilities. Probably one of the most important things we can do of helping to set a generation who could advance the common good is by the time they graduate high school, for them to actually have a sense of what are they good at, and maybe how could God use opportunities there. And if they say, well, I'm really good at playing video games, but I don't know how I make money off of it. Well, actually, there's a whole industry that now creates video games. So one of the great things about the current generation of millennials is that they have tremendous entrepreneurial energy. So encourage them to think about how can you create the kind of job that you're looking for. And it may take you actually inventing a whole industry. Another thing that I found is that there is what we call the iceberg effect of leadership. Most of what great leaders do happens below the surface. What you and I see that's above the surface is just the tip of the iceberg. Most of what leaders spend their time, energy, anxiety around are things that happen below the surface. Why? It's because leaders spend their time doing 2 things. Either trying to make good things come about that in the end don't materialize, so they don't go around and say, oh, well, we almost merged with this company, but it fell through. No, they just sort of continue on with their business. Or they spend a lot of time trying to keep bad things from becoming worse or becoming public. And so they're spending all this time below the surface. And I actually found that's actually what most of government does, is they're doing that sort of stuff. Certainly at senior levels in our government, at the local, state, and federal level. Business, that's happened. In education, so I'm a college president. I spend most of my time either trying to create good opportunities that for one reason or another don't materialize in the time that I'm hoping, or I'm trying to keep bad things from becoming public or from becoming worse. And that is why I concluded that a leader's best work rarely sees the light of day. Most of the great acts of leadership do not get covered by the news media. Some of the most significant things that have happened in our culture in our lifetimes have been things, crises averted, that you and I are blissfully unaware of. And that's actually true in our schools, right? So most of our students have no idea of how close we came to some big problem coming to the surface, but in the end it did not. I'm dealing with student life. Boy, let me tell you, there are lots of things that can happen. Am I right? Lots of things that can happen in student life where you're working to just keep it below the surface and to also give the appearance that everything is calm while at the same time you're paddling underneath that water pretty fast. A leader's best work often doesn't see the light of day. A third thing that we found that is important in shaping the moral imagination of leaders who are committed to the common good is what we would call the crucible of crisis. Here's the interesting thing. Character is rarely developed in the crucible of crisis. It's just revealed. Character is rarely developed in the crucible of crisis. All that happens is your character is revealed in the middle of that crisis. So this is Andy Card, who served as chief of staff to President George W. Bush. This is the very moment where he's whispering into President Bush's ear about the 2 Twin Towers, the second Twin Tower being attacked. And this is the moment of crisis, right? And when I interviewed Andy Card, I said, you know, how did that experience shape your character? And he said, Michael, when you're in a crisis moment, you have no time for character formation. You're just actually responding out of instinct. He said, actually, when you go to Washington, you are coasting on the moral, intellectual, and spiritual developments you've spent for a whole lifetime. You're relying upon that. You don't have time to develop it. Now, crisis provides learning experiences that we process after the crisis has passed, and that becomes a part of our own sort of character formation. But one of the key things that I think we have got to help our young people be prepared for is that crisis is coming to them and into their life. And one of the real issues that I think is a challenge for us in the church is that we've not done a good job of helping our young people to establish really deep roots so that when the storm comes, they can actually still stand. I am shocked by how many Christian young people wither in the moment of crisis. We actually need people who can take a stand. And I'm not saying being defiant. I'm not saying be argumentative. I'm just saying don't compromise your moral convictions. Temptation rarely comes in a moment of tremendous crisis. It always occurs in small little steps. I would give a talk when I was a faculty member at Rice. I give a talk to parents, and I would say, your son or daughter has a strong likelihood of coming back home in May a very different person than they are today. And the interesting thing about it is that it will not be one big decision that they make that causes them to be a different person than they were when they came. No, it's going to be a series of decisions. They're going to make a decision on Friday night, and then that decision might have an implication for what they do next Friday night. And then that might affect what they do the week later. And what happens is you never sort of take a big giant leap across a chasm. Instead, you take little small steps that reorient you. And by the end of an entire year, you're in a very different place than you were before. We have to do a much better job of helping develop what, you know, Eugene Peterson calls the long obedience in the same direction, helping young people to sort of think about their lives in a holistic way and to be prepared for the crucible of crisis. It is coming to every single one of the young people we work with. We don't know what it will look like, but it is coming, and so we have to help them cultivate a lifetime of that obedience. Simple things like spiritual disciplines, you know, the old sort of tried and true things like a daily time of prayer, regular Sabbath worship, these are basic things really important for us to cultivate in the young people we work with. Another thing that we found that is incredibly important is that leadership today has what we might call a priestly dimension to it. So you cannot think of an iPhone without thinking of Steve Jobs. He so much embodies the values and the expectations of Apple Computer that now most of leaders are seen as being sort of completely enmeshed with their organization. For good or for evil, in our culture today, you are the job. It grows out of your individual personality, and that's especially true in leadership positions. Now, that can have a really difficult, problematic element when there's a collapsing of the personal and professional. And one of the things that I've found is that people really struggled about the ways in which they go about their daily routines and their rituals, and particularly about the work-family life balance and how that's set up. I concluded that it is possible to have an incredibly demanding job like being the CEO of a Fortune 500 company, and it is also possible to have an enriching family life. You can do both of those things. There's just not time to do much more. You don't have time for hobbies. You don't have time for golf. You don't have time for some things that you used to be able to do. And when I asked these leaders, people who had incredibly very regimented, very full schedules in their life, it was regimented in the sense that it was a constant grind, but every day was different. So leaders who would, you know, one day they're in Minneapolis, the next day they're in New York City, the next day they're doing something in Rochester, they're sort of all over. How do you create normalcy? And in particular, how do you parent well? What I concluded is that the most important thing that we can do as leaders in trying to cultivate, especially if you have kids that are still at home, is creating family rituals and routines. Why? Because kids crave routines. And so you just begin to institute something that can work into your life. So I found, for example, the CEO of eBay scheduled that Sunday morning pancakes with his kids was just sort of sacred, and he was going to make sure that virtually every Sunday he would make pancakes for his kids. Ralph Larson was the CEO of Johnson & Johnson. He was CEO of Johnson & Johnson for over a decade, but he had Sunday night pizzas with his kids. And he said, it did not matter where I had to be on Monday morning, I was actually at home for Sunday night pizza. That became part of their ritual. Other people say, you know, it's hard for me to do a weekly ritual, but once a month we had family movie night. And so on a Friday night every month, that was something that we did, and my kids looked forward to it. Or they say, every July 4th week, we always vacationed at the same spot. That routine and ritual had a way of normalizing kids, even if the professional life was very demanding. Now, I find that this works not if you're this, not just if you're CEO of a Fortune 500 company, but it works if you're, you know, a high school teacher. All of us are leading busy lives, but there's a way in which if you create rituals into your family life, it has a way of helping to cultivate the kind of family life that you're looking for. A third thing that I found that really matters is the importance of there being integrity between your words and your actions. This is Glenn Tilton. He serves as the CEO of United Airlines. And Glenn was in the midst of trying to negotiate with the labor unions in Chicago. As it turned out, that particular year when they were in these intense negotiations, all the management committee of United lived in Chicago, as did most of the union leaders. So they would meet, there was a Ritz-Carlton hotel that they met in downtown Chicago, and that's where they had these negotiations. And they would sometimes go late into the night. Glenn and his team were trying to get the unions to make some concessions so that the hourly workers would basically give up $2 an hour in their pay. And he was trying to sort of push them to do that. And he said, you know, these negotiations were going into late into the night, 1 or 2 a.m. So finally, we just decided that the executives, we would just book a block of rooms for them at the hotel so that they could, you know, stay at the hotel and not have to go back home. Now, understand, they did that for the executives, not for the union leaders. And this is in a city where all of them actually lived. So I said, let me get this right, Glenn. You're asking people to be willing to give up, say, a 25% pay cut over these negotiations when you're having them, and you and your cronies decided you're just going to, you know, book rooms at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel. So the optics of that just don't work all that well. There has to be integrity between your actions and your words. One of the key things that I found in my research is that if leaders really wanted to demonstrate moral conviction, if they wanted to demonstrate, frankly, Christian witness in their chosen vocations, the most powerful way to do that is through a measure of sacrifice, of giving something up that people think is rightfully yours. Maybe it's a good parking space, maybe it's being able to cut in line for lunch, or maybe it's having, you know, end of year bonus. But an element of sacrifice is one of the most powerful ways in which we can bear witness to our faith. That's actually how we demonstrate integrity. It's not by leading a prayer breakfast movement once a year. It's actually by living it out on a day-to-day basis. One of the things that we try to do in our particular work in Christian higher ed is to create an environment where students actually have the freedom to cultivate that moral imagination. Now, I wouldn't be doing my job as Gordon College's president if I didn't say, Gordon College is a great school and you should all come to Gordon College. We try to do four kinds of things every single day. One is we try to create an environment where students have genuine academic freedom. I actually think that we have more academic freedom at Gordon College than we did at Rice University, where I used to teach. And the reason is because every single question is available to us. We're willing to engage all those kind of key issues. Whereas in most of higher education today, there is a political correctness that puts a whole segment of possible answers and questions out of conversation. We don't have that experience. A second thing that I think is really important is that we believe it's important for young people to actually ask their deepest doubts and to bring some of their misgivings about the Christian faith out on the table. If we don't expose, if we're not exposed to their doubts, and if we don't provide an opportunity for them to raise some of those key questions, then you actually don't have an opportunity to help them move past those doubts. Too often in the church, we're afraid of those doubts being raised. We're afraid that it's going to sort of make people think, oh, maybe they're not a Christian, or maybe they're not on the right path toward righteousness, when in fact, millennials today are more interested in asking questions than being given answers. And so we're trying to create an environment where students have this freedom within a framework of faith. We think it's also important for them to be able to develop sort of good, wholesome fellowship. One of the things that I was struck by when I went to Gordon is we have a variety show that's called Golden Goose, and it's where representatives from each of the four classes, freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors, put on a variety show. And they're competing for literally a trophy, which is a gold goose that we give to them. And I went to this, and it's a three-hour performance where you've got these four different classes that are competing, and they have videos, and then they have on-stage performances. And about 1,500 students show up to this. In higher education today, if you have a group of college students who perform in front of their peers, you're just pretty much guaranteed it's going to be at least somewhat lewd, right? That there's going to be an element in which they're going to sort of push the envelope in some way. After going to this my first year at Gordon, I turned to my wife and I said, you know, there's actually nothing that was on that stage that I wouldn't want my grandmother to see. And it was so refreshing. Actually, I think that there's a hopeful opportunity today for actually things like humor to actually be funny and not just crass. You know, helping young people to develop those kind of sensibilities, I think, are incredibly important. And then I think it's also important for us to help young people to develop a healthy approach to ambition. The Apostle Paul actually wrote several times about godly ambition. By him saying that, it actually suggests that ambition in and of itself is not bad or wrong. It has to be channeled in the right direction. So what we're wanting to do is to try and help raise the aspirations of young people to help them to see, yeah, it's actually a good and noble thing for you to seek opportunities to lead. We just have to channel that in a way in where you're actually, it's more about service than about self-promotion. Where the model that you see in most student governments and most of what you see in politics or other places in organizational life, those are not the models, but actually we're trying to sort of live out a New Testament sort of approach to how do you actually do godly and embrace godly ambition. I think that that's incredibly important. John Calvin had this notion of vocation where he likened one's vocation to a sentry post, like a military assignment. And Calvin says, you're given this vocation so that you don't heedlessly wander about the earth. Very Calvinistic understanding, right? So like, this is what you're gonna do, son, and you're stuck there. You're predestined for it. This is how you're gonna be, right? And this is where you're going to stay. And there's something to that, right? That because I have this particular calling, I know I'm never going to be an NFL quarterback. And so I can just sort of put that whole part of my life, I can move on. I can say that's not going to be part of my future. And it is helpful, I think, for young people to develop a sense of vocation that in some ways helps them to say there's certain things that maybe you're interested in, but that's not going to be your given vocation. But Karl Barth in the 20th century had a different approach, which I think is probably more akin to what millennials are wanting to talk about today. Instead of likening it to a sentry post, Barth says Christian vocation is like a journey to new harbors. It has this progressive element that you go into one harbor and you're in that particular place for a certain time, but then God actually can move you on to some other kind of place, some other kind of opportunity. And actually, the research shows that millennials are probably going to have anywhere from 5 to 10 different careers over their lifetime. Not jobs, careers. They actually change very different sort of things. How many of you have actually done 3 very different sort of fields over the course of your professional life? Show of hands? Yeah. So it's very common for us to have that kind of movement that happens in a notion of Christian vocation. One of the things that we're trying to do as we're trying to evoke this moral imagination and this liberal arts approach to life and to leadership is to instill in these 20-year-olds an understanding of how God could call them to different tasks and responsibilities, but for there to be this connective tissue through it all of God's call on their life. If you had told me 5 years ago that I'd be standing as the president of Gordon College, I would have said, you're crazy. Because at the time, I was a faculty member at Rice, was very happy. My wife grew up in Dallas, and we had lived in Princeton, New Jersey, lived in Oxford, England, and then we got the call to go to Rice. Rebecca says that there's a lasso that gets around the neck of a native Texan, and the further they are from the state line, the tighter of the pull back to the motherland. And so when we got the call to go to Houston, she was so happy. We were close to her family, we were relatively close to my family, and we felt like we were just right in the right place. And so I never dreamed that God would call me to Boston. I thought that I would be there for, I really thought I would be in Houston at least for the next 15 years and probably for the rest of my life. I was very happy, felt like it was exactly where I should be. I won't bore you with all the details, but as it turned out, God actually ended up calling me to this place, to Gordon, and it's been one of the most tremendous blessings of my life, but I could never have predicted it. My hunch is that you and I could probably tell lots of examples of how what we're experiencing right now, we never imagined for one reason or another. And in some ways, it may feel like luck or chance or things that sort of a confluence of events, but somehow in God's providence, it's actually where He has led us to be in this place and this time. What we want to try and cultivate is this moral imagination that will sustain this generation of young people that God has called us to serve in a way that helps them advance the common good wherever they might be, whatever that harbor might be that God has called them to, and for them to do it in a way that honors both Christ and advances the common good. I think that's both our challenge and the opportunity we have in working with young people today. Thank you very much. So, who's got some questions, things you're curious about? Please, and would you mind telling me your name and what keeps you busy?
My name's Glenn Brad.
Yeah, okay, good.
You know, you spoke about liberal arts and having various interests, not being so narrow, but what I see happening in especially public education is we're educating kids for a job.
Yeah.
We're telling them that the ultimate purpose of an education is to get a job.
Yes.
And with my daughter, she's 13, she's always saying, why do you need to learn this? How does that help me get a job?
Yeah.
It's just a constant reframing.
Right.
So I don't know how we... I'm encouraged by some of the movements of people starting these schools that have classical education and all of that. I think that's a kind of a bright light.
Yeah, it's very interesting. So actually, you know, cultures change like pendulum swings, right? That you see different sort of adjustments. And the last 10 years, there's been this real move in K-12 education, and certainly in higher education, toward professionalization and sort of preparing young people for a particular job. At the very moment that that has occurred in our context, we're seeing that actually the rest of the world is moving in a very different pendulum swing. It's interesting. So American higher education is the glory of the world. We are the global gold standard. And part of what has made American higher education so effective is that it has resisted that professionalization impulse that Europe experienced for 100 years. That we actually don't think that you go to college to learn a trade, but is actually to prepare you for sort of lifetime of learning in many different roles. Asia, which originally had adopted this European, or in particular a British model, where it was a three-year degree program that was sponsored, that was organized around a narrow set of fields. Hong Kong's eight major universities just changed 3 years ago to go from the three-year British model to the four-year liberal arts approach in the United States. So the rest of the world has actually recognized what America has been doing is actually the right way. So I actually think that probably as the world has moved back in a way that sort of aligns with where the U.S. has been, I think that the professional impulse is actually coming back. So you see it in the emergence of these classical Christian schools or charter schools, which are sort of embracing this more liberal arts approach. We're seeing it, for example. I mean, we have students who are preparing for careers in finance, but they're actually majoring in English. Or they're interested in going to med school, but they decide that they're going to double major in philosophy. That tends to be certainly the more prevalent sort of approach we're seeing among our young people, and we're trying to sort of encourage more of that. I think that you're going to find that over the next 10 years, that pendulum is going to swing much more back toward that liberal arts approach, because it's what's actually allowed American education to be some of the best in the world. Please.
My name is Joe. My five children keep me busy.
Yeah, good.
Question I have for you, which is, may sound a little out there, but what do you see coming through pop culture, Hollywood? I think movies being more influential in terms of the approach of specialization, trade. How do you see it influencing the culture? Because I see themes coming through movies where exactly what you just spoke to, where there's the, you were from birth tagged to do this, and that's kind of the culture that this movie or time period this movie takes place in. Mm. I don't know if you ever saw the movie Gattaca, but something along those lines.
Right, yep.
How do you see that in the culture?
Yeah, so this is very interesting. So I spent about a year looking at social movements of the last 150 years in American society to look and see where did they start and how did they actually get developed. And it's interesting because there are two industries that were the birthplace of more social movements of the last 150 years than any other industries in our society. Can you guess which they are?
Sports and Hollywood.
No, sports is a good guess, but it's not. But it is. So media, entertainment is one. And what's the other?
Music.
Well, music I would sort of include in that. What'd you say?
Religion.
Not religion, but the academy. New ideas and new social movements actually got started in the academy and the arts. Those are the two sort of arenas. And so, and actually the last institutional sector to embrace a social movement is actually politics. So Washington is basically they ratify public opinion, they rarely shape it. In fact, aside from the civil rights movement in the 1960s, you can rarely see the federal government being on the leading edge of cultural change. They always just sort of endorse it. Look at the LGBT movement. Where did it get started? In the academy and in entertainment. You think about the first sympathetic sitcoms that had a gay character, that actually began to influence young people early on. And then you think about K-12 education and how examples that were used in textbooks where you sort of introduce the idea of a gay couple having a child, actually that begins to influence a whole generation of young people. So cultural change typically occurs through arts, entertainment, media, and the academy. That's how it actually gets started. So Hollywood is incredibly important, and that's why I think it's incredibly important we have more people of faith in those arenas. The good news is that things have really changed in Hollywood since 2004, when we had The Passion of the Christ and we had the Chronicles of Narnia series. Both of those became the top grossing films in box office history, and so they demonstrated that there's actually a segment of the audience that wants that kind of entertainment. And so every major studio in Hollywood now has at least a faith dimension, say an office that's actually trying to cultivate and develop films. And you can think about The Blind Side, right? I mean, these kinds of films actually become very significant in helping to reshape sort of an orientation. What we're finding is that media, like most of our culture, is becoming bimodal. So you may have movies like The Blind Side, but you have other movies that are really sort of in a very different place. I earlier this week, I was at a conference in the UK, and on the flight over, I was just trying to find something to watch, and I was struck by how much of the entertainment that I'm watching on this British Airways flight, there are sex scenes that I can actually just watch now here on my seat back that 15 years ago wouldn't actually even shown up on TV, not HBO, not Showtime, and now I can actually just get it on my seat back on an airplane. So there's a division that's occurred where things are getting racier, steamier, more violent, but also there's a dimension where there's things that are more wholesome than ever before, and you've got that sort of bimodal distribution. That's why we need to have more people of faith in places like Hollywood. Yeah, please.
All right, let's see if I can ask this. There was recently an article that came out in The Atlantic. It was, I don't know if you saw it, it was called something like The Coddling of the American Student. Does anyone know the title?
Yeah. I don't know the title, I've read the article.
Yeah, amazing article. And it's all about trigger warnings and the politically correct speech that we're all being encouraged to use in at least secular universities.
Yes.
And it's really big. I mean, it's moving fast. It's like this tidal wave just coming through. And when you talked earlier about helping students to get their grounding so that when a crisis comes, they can stand. And then you talked about with parents having rituals. And what other recommendations do you have for parents raising teenagers and kids getting ready to go to college so that they don't need trigger warnings?
Right.
I mean, everyone's going to experience some trauma in their life. They are.
Yes.
But every single person in here may have experienced something that somewhere along the line something's going to be said that makes you, oh my gosh, that brings back this memory or whatever. But that article really, I mean, it's going pretty far.
Yes. So my mom used to say, your weaknesses are just your strengths carried too far. So if you have a weakness of being sort of overly demanding or harsh, actually, that means you also have probably the strength of confidence or ability to articulate your convictions, you've just carried it a bit too far. And I think what's happened is that the good intention of trying to serve and to help young people who have faced trauma or had difficulties, have those are good and helpful things. And there are appropriate realms for trigger warnings, if you're going to think of that broadly. But what's happened is that we're just creating a buffered self, where we're constantly thinking of ourselves as if we're in therapy, and that the whole idea is to just wrap our kids in bubble wrap so that they never actually encounter the hard walls or the sharp angles. This, I think, is actually a fad in education, that I think what we're seeing, certainly in higher education, there are segments, you know, some of the most liberal professors on university campuses are saying, this is getting ridiculous. The whole point of education is actually to disorient young people, and now you're making it where we can't disorient them at all. So I actually think that we're going to sort of see that particular, that you're right, it has come on very strong. And I think there'll be dimensions in which that's still the case. I think, for example, sexual assault and things about trigger warnings around sexual assault or rape, that's here to stay. I don't think that's going to change. But the idea that, you know, Song of Solomon, you know, if you're covering it in Old Testament class, needs a trigger warning, I mean, give me a break. So there's a way in which I think that we're going to sort of see that this has come on like a wave, but then it also sort of passes like a, you know, a fad. What I think is really important is that we have to be very intentional about thinking about where young people are developmentally and to allowing them to experience pressure and challenges. Probably the most important thing that we can actually do in the among Christian young people is to encourage them to take more risks. We are too afraid for our kids to fail. And actually, if there is anything that we want our young people to experience before they go off to university, is failure. Because in the context of being at home, we can actually help them make sense of that so that they can prepare for when the next failure comes. Because all of us are going to experience failure. I mean, we experience it probably on a weekly basis. But something has told us, and I think some of it is the sort of Asian influence in K-12 education of uber performance and uber confidence. And so we want perfect kids, and we want to sort of build a resume where it's a fortress resume by the time they're in 12th grade so that they can somehow magically get into what somehow is perceived as their ideal school. When in fact, I can tell you, when I'm interviewing young people for our most selective leadership opportunities, I'm actually asking them about their most spectacular failure. I want to know, I'm working with young people who have stretched themselves further than they could actually reach and failed and learned through that process. If you don't have that kind of failure, then I think that you probably have not pushed yourself hard enough. So those kind of practical things, I think, make a positive difference. Other questions?
We'll go ahead.
Yeah, please. Wallace?
So interviewed, you know, all these people, and I'm just curious, what were the one or two ahas that you took and applied in your own leadership style?
That's a great question. One or two ahas. So I got lots. One big aha was that I fully expected that family of origin, early childhood experiences, and sort of growing up years would have a much more profound influence than actually end up being. So I'm the parent of young kids, and so I care very deeply about nurturing the next generation. I have 11-year-olds and then twins who are 5. And I expected that you would be able to predict a lot about people's leadership trajectory based on, you know, what kind of family they were born into, what kind of experiences that they had when they were 10 years old, you know, what they were like in high school. Actually, we could not find a single variable that you could measure before age 20 that had a statistically significant relationship with one's likelihood of assuming this position of leadership or not. It actually did not matter. Now, that's not to say that, you know, caring for our kids and making sure they get good education and involved in church, those are all very important. But what it means, I think, is actually a word of hope, which is that you actually still have time, you know, if things don't get all lined up. What matters more significantly is what happens between ages 20 and 40. We found that those were the important decades of catalytic growth. And the 20s and 30s were far more significant in developing your trajectory than what happened before 20 or after 40. Why? Because after 40, nobody wants to be your mentor. They think you're old enough at that point to stand on your own. And before age 20, you just there's not enough to sort of isolate those experiences. What we try to do based upon that is to create those kind of catalytic experiences where you experience some serious failure, take some real risks, and have some real opportunities to prove yourself. So that was a big aha. On the personal side, I was struck by how important it was as a Christian for me to bridle ambition in my life. That I realized that even though I wasn't going to be the CEO of a Fortune 500 company, I had some of the same tendencies, and some of those are gifts, but that you really have to harness ambition or else it gets out ahead of you before you know it. And so how do you bridle ambition? Well, the most profound way to do it is regular Sabbath keeping. And that's not sort of being hard and fast about, you know, doing or not doing certain things on Sunday, but it is like saying every week there is a cessation of ambition and striving, and that you actually have to put that into your life, that there's a way in which you sort of say, it's not all about me. And so my wife and I made a commitment that basically from Saturday dinner to Sunday dinner, that I would largely be off of electronic devices, that I really wouldn't use that as time to catch up on my reading or to do other things, that we would really try and sort of safeguard that, to hold in abeyance whatever my professional calling was at that time. So when I was a grad student, this actually occurred while I was doing my dissertation. And so I basically reoriented my life so that from Saturday dinner to Sunday dinner, I didn't do homework, I didn't do reading, I didn't do other things, but I really tried to nurture family relationships. I tried to be actively involved in a local house of worship, and I actually tried to take a break.
Please.
Yeah, so you mentioned something about helping young people understand what they're truly good at. Mm-hmm. So this is something I spend a lot of time doing because I'm a career counselor.
Oh, great.
So then what are some things that you at Gordon are looking at in order to help students kind of do some of this vocational exploration?
Yeah, thanks. So this is something that I think is incredibly important. We have made a real commitment to increasing job shadowing opportunities and internship possibilities for more experimentation. So over the last 5 years, we've had 78% of participation in college-sponsored internships, so where we broker internship possibilities. Probably the biggest shift that we've gone about is on the first day of orientation. So this is the very first thing that happens. I have all the parents are there, all the students. I have called them into one big assembly. We don't do this for anything else in orientation, and it's a time where I bring them together and say, starting today, it's time for you to think about what you're doing next summer. It's time for you to think about what are you going to do that's going to help you discern what God's calling you to do. And so, while it has been very helpful, and I've made a lot of money myself by babysitting, lifeguarding, and cutting yards, those days have passed, and it's time for you to actually think about what is God calling you to do professionally. And so I say to the parents, you want to encourage your son or daughter this summer to really try out a vocation. And if that means that they can't get paid by doing it, give them the grace not to make money this summer so that they can try something out by visiting, observing, volunteering in a particular field so that the next summer they can actually get a paid internship. And so we lay out for them, we say that basically by Thanksgiving, they ought to have 5 opportunities that they're actively pursuing, specific opportunities. And it doesn't matter if it's here on campus in Boston or if it's back home, but they need to be thinking about it. And by Christmas, they need to have had conversations with 5 organizations that actually would help them achieve that. And we're trying to sort of move them through a process. The key thing that I have found is that most young people just don't know what to do. They're like clueless. They know they need to find something, but they need a roadmap. And so we try to sort of make it very straightforward and help them to sort of discover it. We have found, and probably it's been your experience as well, that vocational discernment is a little bit about trial and error. You know, it's sort of trying something out, seeing if you can do something or if you enjoy it. It's much more important to us that they find something that they love or feel passionate about, and then once they figure that out, for us to find a career opportunity that would somehow be in that ecosystem. That doesn't mean you always get to do what you love. So I tell them, I love being college president, but there's lots of stuff I hate doing. But it's just part of the vocation. So helping them to sort of get that and try it out, I think, has made a big difference. And the work you're doing makes a big difference as well. So, nice to meet you, Carla. Please.
Nathan Miller, and I'm a youth pastor and work with the Made the Flourish Network. Really curious for you to take 10 years and do all these interviews. Certainly, it's not about one-upping their story. And yet that's kind of the inclination whenever we even work with students. We hear their story, and then we want to talk about how in college we similarly did what you just did, or, oh, that's interesting, yeah. Like, there's this impulse to interject our own kind of thinkings or our personalities or how we see the world based upon their stories. And I'm curious, because you couldn't do that to have that many effective interviews, how do we guard against maybe projecting our own views of the world onto their unique kind of packaging as they, because we really want to see them flourish in their own, you know, uniquenesses. Thoughts on that?
So that's the most natural impulse to parenting, isn't it? Right? That we just, I mean, if you think about, you know, when you're parenting, when you encounter a challenge or an issue in your child's life, the most natural thing is to sort of impute your own experiences around this and to sort of move them through it. I think that so I don't think I do a great job as a parent in this regard. In my work, I think I would say that when you interview as many different people as I did, I began to just recognize, frankly, the wideness of how God works in the world and how surprising it is to me. So the more sort of stories I encountered, the more I was sort of surprised by, gosh, there's redemptive value. I mean, I interviewed a guy who is basically the CEO of a trash company. They pick up trash. And he's able to sort of speak in theologically astute ways about how he's advancing the common good by picking up trash. I said, if you can do that, then that really is pretty impressive. One of the key things that sort of was an insight for me was just how God uses sort of this multiplicity of avenues in which his glory is revealed. And so that probably has sort of conditioned me to, at least working with my students, to be less likely to sort of impose things in. The other thing that I think is most important, it's sort of my basic rule of preaching, is that you never really want to tell stories where you yourself are the hero, where you are the one who's got it figured out. You actually want to tell stories where you're actually the counterexample, the person who messed up or had the failure. So it's far more important when you're helping to mentor develop a young person to, instead of saying, oh yeah, this is how I figured that out, it's actually much better to tell stories about how you didn't figure it out or it didn't work out that well. That's far more instructive. And of course, that actually makes you a closer mentor to them as well. Please.
Mike DiNardo from Minneapolis Academy. Any of the people you interviewed and you learned, wow, I would never want to lead like this person, or what were some of those really negative aspects that you learned?
So I'm being recorded, so I want to be careful of what I say. I interviewed, yeah, sadly, there were. I mean, you interview 550 people, there's some bad apples in the group. I interviewed a man who, I won't give you his name, but he had spent his whole career building up a financial services firm. And by the time I interviewed him, it had been wildly successful. If I said the name of it, you would instantly recognize it. And he pretty much had built it himself. He was solely devoted to it, and it had been his obsession for 45 years. And I was interviewing him at age 85. As it turned out, about 3 years before the interview, he had been forced out of the CEO job because of a moral failure, an ethical issue. And it was devastating for him because so much of his life was in his identity as a CEO. Remember how I said, for good or for ill, you are the job? That was very true for this man. And so he decided when he was forced out of that job that he would actually go and spend his time and energy in another competitor or other organization with the sole goal of trying to build it up to rival the organization he had built. And I said to him, you know, you're 85 years old. Don't you want to spend time with your kids and your grandkids? And isn't there something else you want to do? And he turned to me and he said, Michael, there is nothing else. And I just thought, if your whole world is oriented around that kind of professional ambition, life just had sort of a hollowness about it. And he was very much a cautionary tale for me. And I decided that's really not the kind of life I want to lead. So, there were some examples of folks who sort of fit in that category. John.
This morning in this room at 6:30 there, we had a group of guys that meet, and we were talking in James 1. We actually didn't get to it today, but we'll get to it the next time, where James warns against favoring the wealthy and slighting the poor. So you're talking to leaders that are in the elite tier of their organizations. How did that, does that, and you're dealing now with students who are going to be going, you know, full gamut.
Right.
How did that sensibility factor into even your conversations or your thinking about evaluating these leaders and the kinds of things that they were talking about?
So probably one of the biggest crisis of faith that I experienced was I'm working on this dissertation project, and I think my faith is important to me, and I begin to sort of think deeply theologically about power and privilege, and thought, am I just sort of baptizing it with some holy water on the top of a veneer of raw ambition and power? Am I just sort of trying to build up wealth and fame and status and all the things that actually I think the gospel preaches against? Am I guilty of sort of somehow trying to make that feel like it's spiritually acceptable? And I would say that that's something that anybody who deals with leadership has to actually evaluate, not just once and done, but actually on an ongoing basis. So being in the Word, friends who hold you accountable have a way of doing that. Probably the one of my best friends is a guy named Andy Crouch, who is an editor for Christianity Today. And Andy and I were both grappling with these issues around the same time. We're close to the same age. And Andy had a very keen insight, which I think was really important. And he said, what you actually have to do as a leader is that there has to be an equal measure of both authority and vulnerability. That's actually how the gospel sort of helps you to use whatever power, influence, or authority you have in a way that honors Christ. And, the disciples were basically begging Jesus to repudiate the Roman authorities. They so much expected him and his vision for God's kingdom to be sort of so prophetic against the ruling authorities. And actually, that's not what Jesus does. If anything, he sort of allows it to continue to exist and sort of render unto Caesar what Caesar's and unto God what is God's. I mean, it's such a countercultural sort of stance. And the reason, I think, is because there are so many wonderful examples throughout the biblical witness and throughout church history of people who did actually have real cultural influence and power, but who appropriately had that sort of element of both holding both authority and vulnerability together and not letting it go. Probably the most important thing, I think, practically for those folks who are in leadership positions is for them to have regular contact with people who have severely less resources and opportunities than they do. So that's why I think that's why one of the things that I worry about in the church is that we've basically become sort of separate enclaves where we're sort of with the same people, the same socioeconomic status as ourselves. It used to be that church was one of the very few places in America where the bank teller and the bank president knew each other as people together. And we've moved away from that over the last 25 years, but that actually has been a real hallmark of American Christianity. So one of the things that I try to encourage our students to do and in my own life is to make sure that there are regular parts of your life that are in contact and are exposed to the need for you to remain vulnerable. The interesting thing about it, John, is that most of the leaders who really impressed me were people who had a dimension of their life that caused them to have to be vulnerable. A severely disabled child, a part of deep pain in their own sort of life that sort of kept them grounded in a way that you wouldn't sort of expect. And so I think that's a really important way in which you hold the message of James 1 true in your life. Yeah. Please.
Just to follow up on that, in my reflections on William Wilberforce, I think about how, thank God, that John Newton, he has this conversion experience, and he thinks, maybe I should get out of politics altogether and out of Parliament and go into the ministry full time. And Newton, advised him differently, and thank God he did. And
right.
I think of the impact he had
exactly.
where he was.
And
I find today so often ministers are really giving bad advice to people. They're really not geared to be in the ministry. They love God, they're passionate about it, but they think just because a person's been passionate about God doesn't mean they're going full time ministry.
And I
find that error happening more often.
Well, I have to say,
this relates to vocation.
Yeah, I think I'm actually encouraged by what I've seen happen in at least the last 10 years, where there's sort of been more encouragement of Christian vocation, thinking about Christian vocation in business or Christian vocation in the arts. I'm encouraged about that, but you're right, that's a very important sort of element. Please.
Since back to the power and privilege thing, as we're working with students and young people, how do you cultivate what you call the stewardship of power and privilege in the having contact with people who have less? But how do we, I don't know, do you have other ideas of how to?
Yeah, I think it's really important that whenever you're working with student leaders, is to actually ask them to identify what are the best privileges or perks that you get from this job or this role. So if you're in student government, what are the benefits of it? And then how can you identify at least one thing you're going to willingly give up of those perks or privileges as a form of Christian discipleship? And that's sort of a practical thing that I think actually helps cultivate the kind of virtues we're wanting. Yep.
I didn't introduce myself earlier, so Wally Booby and I am the director of the Physician Assistant Program at Bethel.
Oh, great, hi.
With three teenagers at home and worked with the junior high youth at our church.
Great.
So I get all the ages. We talk about leading, we talk about, privilege or power. But really, as my wife and I talk about with our kids, we're all called to be leaders, whether it's at home, at church, in our communities, whatever. So how do you, because some kids may come back and say, well, I'm not a leader.
Yeah.
How do you foster that?
I just remind them that to live in American society today is to be in the top 2% of the world's population. So you're already in the 90th percentile. So you can say you're not a leader, but actually nobody in the world would buy that. So it's time to sort of just own into the privileges that you've been given and to think about how do you actually steward that in a helpful way. Less than 1% of the world's population goes to college. So any of us who work with university students, we're actually dealing with the 99th percentile of the world's population. So I think that probably one of the biggest wake-up calls that we face, at least in the evangelical church in America, is just a recognition of just how very blessed we are. And with that comes real responsibility. Unto him much is given, much is required. We're blessed in order to be a blessing to others. And I think too many of us squander the blessings we've been given. So I try to make my students uncomfortable with the reality that they have more privilege and blessings than they could possibly imagine. Because there's something freeing when you don't feel like you don't have it as good as somebody else. And I just remind them, tell my friends in Rwanda that. Because they'd be really glad to trade places with you. And then helping the students to think sort of theologically and practically about how they steward that power and influence in the right way. Yeah. Well, let's, final
one
question.
Last one, sorry,
sure,
Joel,
of course.
Again. Feminism. Can you speak to that, at least, like Gordon, how you see it manifest and how you address it or live with it? Or?
So say a little bit more about, feminism is kind of a big term.
Right. Well, what I'm asking for specifically. I had a student that just graduated. She's off at the U now, and I was asking her, kind of an exit interview as she was heading off to school. I said, what are you reading now? What's new? What are you excited about? And she was really excited about a book she was reading on feminism. I can't remember the exact name of the book, but I knew it wasn't a Christian viewpoint. It was just a secular book. And I found myself a little nervous going, I wonder what that means for this particular student. She's dabbling, exploring. I'm glad she is, but how will that impact her? What is there to counteract it?
Yeah.
But I can't speak anything in particular, specific about feminism, just the movement itself. And I have three daughters that are all young, but yet wondering now, okay, how am I going to incorporate that into life and teaching?
So I'm the father of three young girls, and my own sort of professional and spiritual journey have been deeply influenced by women in my life. My mom, my youth minister was a woman. I grew up in a conservative Southern Baptist church, but we had a woman who was a youth minister. And my first boss in the professional world was a woman. So there have been lots of ways in which I'd say women have deeply influenced me, and Gordon has more women than men. So we want to think about women and prepare them for leadership opportunities and responsibilities. The larger issue that I think you're pointing to is helping young people to respond to and appropriate cultural pluralism in all its different sort of shapes and sizes. People have asked me, you know, do I feel like that we are sort of moving into an era where it's like we're in exile in Babylon? And I say, no, actually, I don't think it's that. I think we're much more like we're in Samaria. The difference between Babylon and Samaria is that in Babylon, most of the people there, the Babylonians, they didn't really know what the Jews believed, and they weren't really engaged with it. Samaria, they knew what the Jews believed, and they didn't actually like it. I think that the challenge that we face is that the wider culture, they at least know a lot more about Jesus than we think that they do, but they know it in the way that we have appropriated it. They don't really sort of know Jesus, the good Jesus. They sort of know the cultural Jesus. And so what we've got to do in a pluralistic marketplace is figure out how you hold two things in tension together, which John's gospel describes Jesus in John chapter 1 being full of both grace and truth. And I really think that that's the key for engaging a pluralistic environment. And I think it's important that John, who is a very careful writer of the Gospels, I mean, he uses the word grace before truth. I think the order of that mattered, that you had to actually experience the grace of Jesus before you could appropriate his truth. And I think that's really what we have to do in the church today, is to hold those two things together so that folks will recognize that we're holding firm on our truth, but we also are doing it in a way that's gracious and loving. I've found that that's been far more important when I'm working with young people and preparing them for whatever they might experience in a pluralistic environment. Principled pluralism is one of the things that we're trying to encourage. We actually want there to be a flourishing of pluralism, because in so doing, I think the gospel will win out, right? I think it's the best argument there is, as long as we're given a hearing. And helping our young people to be prepared for that by living out a life of grace and truth, I think, makes a real difference. Well, listen, it's been great being here with you all. Thank you very much. God bless you all. Okay.